Hello, I'm Jenni Murray, mother of two boys and presenter of Woman's Hour on BBC Radio 4. I've always resisted the trend invariably to describe me as a broadcaster, journalist and mother of two. They never do that to dads. And I would never say in public that my children are my greatest achievement. But to be honest, I'm no different from any other mother, and they are. So there. Over the years, I've interviewed hundreds, if not thousands, of women, and whether they're mothers themselves or not, the matriarchal role has universally dominated their lives. It may be that overwhelming pride in their own children, sadness at the fact they couldn't have children, or the influence of and the passion they feel for their own mothers. For the next hour or so, enjoy a celebration of the single mother, the campaigning mother, the mother-in-law, and the children who grieve for the loss of their mother. We begin with the ultimate mother who goes out to work. She won't be remembered as a mum, but as a prime minister. I spoke to Mrs. Thatcher at Downing Street in 1990, and she looked back to life in 1953, when she was newly delivered of her twins, Mark and Carol, and hoping to pass her law exams.
I think it's always hard when you're trying to do two things, because naturally you're dragged between, your thoughts drag between one and the other. But I had always had the idea the thing to do was to keep working even if only part-time, so that you kept your brain ticking over and kept up to date with the things that were going on. But it was hard. You have to organise things. You have to organise every day. You have to work hard late at night, because that's the only time you really have for thinking without the telephone going. So, yes, it's hard, and you must be strongly motivated to do it.
It's interesting looking at the things that you were writing in the early 50s, your views about women going back to work, saying then that women could do anything and children would come to no harm if women went out to work. How much did you feel you were out on a limb expressing those views in those times?
Well, very much out on a limb. I think I expressed those views right at the beginning of marriage, or
1952 and 54.
52 and 54, and the children were born in 53. Let me say this. Children alter your life completely. You never know how much until you have one. I had twins. They were prematurely born. And so, in the early days, it really required a great deal of attention, because they had to be fed 3 hourly. And there were two of them. And so one couldn't think of going back to work immediately. And they do, they tug away at your heartstrings, obviously. And I remember thinking, if I don't really make an arrangement to go back to work, or make an arrangement to take my final exams, I shall never get down to doing it. And so I consciously made the choice that I really must take my final exams. And they were about 4 or 5 months old when I did it. But that meant that I really had to do the work very late at night. And that's when I got used to working very late at night.
But even the most radical thinking in those early days, yes, in 1952, was that women should, when they have children, stay at home full-time until the children are 6 or 10. Would you have characterised yourself as a feminist in those days?
No, not necessarily. I think something really rather different. We women had been going to university and becoming graduates for quite a long time, even in those days. And yet there were really comparatively few graduate women who were going on to pursue careers. And I did feel that they were not fully making use of their powers and capacities if they didn't. And I thought then there must be some way in which they can use this tremendous brain they've got, both to keep their home going, which is very, very important. I mean, a good home life is the single most valuable thing you can ever start life with, but also have time to do something else. And if they could so arrange their days, they'd also have something else to bring to evening supper to talk about with their husbands, as well as the things that have gone on during the daytime. So it was a conscious effort on my part that really this remarkable privilege we'd had, the 3 years at university, which was, for me, was privilege undreamed of, must somehow be used. And I thought that we could do it by working part-time.
Margaret Thatcher in 1990. Somehow you can't imagine Mrs. T rustling up her children's supper. Indeed, Private Eye had a lot of fun after that interview in a Dear Bill letter where Dennis recalled the boy Mark at the age of four, already programmed to transfer his own frozen supper from the freezer to the microwave. You equally can't picture a great chef like Nigel Slater being brought up on anything but the most wonderful culinary delights prepared by his mother's own fair hand. But when Nigel came into the Woman's Hour studio in September 2003 to discuss a childhood obsessed by food, we discovered his mum was not a natural in the kitchen.
Mum's cooking was something that she just had to do. She didn't really enjoy it. No meal was cooked with any passion. It was part of the deal. You just cooked a meal for the family. And I do remember almost every meal being seasoned with a bit of a sigh, you know, here you are sort of thing.
So what sort of things did she give you that you weren't particularly impressed with?
This was meat and two veg, quite seriously. I don't remember a meal that wasn't. And puddings were, when they were made, were either something like rice pudding, which she couldn't really get wrong, or they were tin sponge puddings and tin fruit. I think we lived in a world of tin fruit. And it wasn't that anything she cooked was horrible. It was that it was very ordinary and, as I say, no love or passion came with it.
You use food as a metaphor for love, and you seem to suggest that your mother couldn't cook brilliantly and serve it with love because she didn't really know how to express love. Is that right?
Mum did express her love. I mean, she was a very caring mum, almost too much so. I mean, to a certain extent, I was slightly mollycoddled by her. My father was a very strict father, somebody who I sort of shied away from. But, I mean, Mum's love was expressed really quite physically. I mean, she was a hugs and cuddles mum. She wasn't here's a cake for tea type mum.
Now, she died when you were very young. And it's so shocking to read what you've written about it and remember how children were hustled away from a parent's death in those days. What actually happened?
I had been cooking with Mum, and it was the last few days before she died. We were making mince pies, and she'd become quite ill. She'd become a little bit scatty at that point, and she'd forgotten some of the ingredients. And I was so upset and so distraught she'd forgotten them that my last words to my mother, realizing she was ill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.